Hi everyone, Omores here. Welcome to the final episode of running legacy Windows operating systems on the Intel i5-14600KF and Asus Prime Z790P Wi-Fi combo. This experiment began when a friend of mine decided to upgrade and asked if I wanted to test Windows 98 on his new PC. Naturally, I said yes. The only catch? Well, I had to put all the parts together, which was hardly an issue since it's something I really enjoy. Now, if you are curious about how things went with Windows 98, check out my previous video, where I also walked through the installation process. That's something we won't cover today, as I had to return the beast and I didn't have time to install from scratch every operating system. However, I did manage to boot from existing installations I had previously set up on a few SSDs for my Intel 13th gen system, mainly to test whether the new CPU with its P-cores and E-cores would cause any issues. The results? Well, 3 out of 4 of my previous Windows installations worked flawlessly. So let's start with another classic Windows NT4 from 1996. It might look like Windows 95 on the surface, but its internals are a whole different story. In any case, with the right of these drivers, NT4 is just as portable as Windows 95. And by portable, I mean we can take a bootable Windows NT drive and run it on a completely different hardware. On top of that, NT4 will quietly reconfigure itself in the background. No prompts, no questions asked. Before we know it, we are at the logon screen, ready to go. This is Windows NT4 running on an Intel 13th gen Raptor Lake i3 CPU. Let's say when I first shared a screenshot on Reddit, on this exact configuration, it got quite a reaction and even got featured on Tom's Hardware. This installation actually originates from my Socket 7 system, where I tested a quite rare AccelGraphics Eclipse OpenGL accelerator that only works with Windows NT. For this setup, I performed a fresh installation using a via PCI 2 SATA and ID adapter. Next, using the same disk configuration, I successfully booted NT4 on my Ryzen 9 3900X PC. Then, the magic touch was to install the UniATA drivers, which enable NT4 to work with any IDE or AHCI compliant chipset, so no extra adapters are required anymore. With these drivers in place, no reinstall is theoretically required, so let's use the same NT4 drive one more time to see how it went on this new motherboard and CPU. To be fair, this time the hardware is not that different, as we are only jumping one CPU generation while staying on the same platform. Meanwhile, I did put back the PCIe ATI X200 card I used on the 13th gen configuration, so if everything is fine with our SATA chipset, we should see the desktop in 32-bit color depth straight from the first boot. And here we are, almost 30 years later, Windows NT4 can still be installed on real physical hardware. Even better, we are running it with the multiprocessor kernel thanks to the multiprocessor specification or MPS support that's still present on Intel motherboards. Now, speaking of MPS, I recall running into some challenges last time I used it, specifically with sound drivers. This is because with MPS, resources are allocated using MPS tables, and not all drivers will play nice with the setup. For instance, the PCIe sound card with a CMI8738 8738 chip that worked perfectly fine in Windows 98 ended up being assigned IRQ128. The driver defaulted to IRQ11, while IRQ12 being the last option, so the driver installation ended up with an unexpected error. Well, didn't try any workarounds, instead I swapped in my trusty Ensoniq PCI-E ES3070 sound card, which comes with a smarter driver that can handle the card at IRQ128. Theoretically sound works now, but the output volume is very low, almost unusable. So I wouldn't call this sound setup exactly a success, but I think there is still room for improvement. Perhaps a fresh reinstall of Windows NT4 could help, especially considering this installation has been through so many different hardware configurations. We'll leave that for another time. Now let's move on to Windows Millennium Edition, or simply Windows ME, which was previously installed on a Kingston SATA M.2 drive using an M.2 to SATA adapter. This time, however, we are going to boot directly from the drive in the M.2 slot without reinstalling. I was curious to see if using the drive directly into M.2 slot might cause any issues. Theoretically, it shouldn't. The AHCI drivers are already installed and I'm using the same GPU as before, the Nvidia 7900GS. Also, the via PCIe to USB 2 adapter is present. With the GPU and USB drivers already loaded, everything should work fine, except for the unnecessary process of manually reinstalling system devices like PCI bridges. The step thankfully was eliminated in later versions of Windows. Anyway, we still need to address the new devices detected on this motherboard, which means pressing a lot of next and finish buttons. The mouse has to wait its turn to be recognized, so navigation relies entirely on the keyboard until that happens. In the end, the AHCI drivers will install as well, and they will take over after a reboot. At this point, our M.2 SATA drive is operating in MS-DOS compatibility mode, but once the AHCI drivers kick in, it can go one of two ways. Either things get messy with disk read errors, or we elevate Windows ME to another level. With AHCI drivers in place, the system no longer relies on the BIOS to manage the drive, and we also unlock crazy fast transfer speeds for a Windows ME setup. As you can see, everything went smoothly. In fact, not a single error occurred during this entire reinstallation, which, let's say, it's not the typical Windows Millennium experience, if you know what I mean. The PCIe 1X C-Media sound card that didn't work in Windows NT4 should install just fine now, especially since we are using drivers specifically released for Windows Millennium. And indeed, no issues with the drivers this time. We'll get back to our sound card later. Now let's check the crazy speeds we can get with the AHCI drivers, as I mentioned before. Obviously, these are not crazy numbers when it comes to an SSD, but it's still something to see hundreds of megabytes per second in Windows Millennium. Anyway, this Kingston drive, it's not exactly the fastest. I got transfer speeds close to 350 megabytes per second while testing other SSDs. However, in practice, it really doesn't matter since the system remains snappy even at 20 megabytes per second, not to mention the virtually non-existent sync time. When it comes to connectivity, I'm using the same USB Wi-Fi stick featured in my previous Windows 98 video. The browsing experience and compatible browsers are exactly the same as for Windows 98, so there is nothing new to show. However, we can try something we didn't do in Windows 98, like checking out our network neighborhood, where my Wi-Fi 6 router is running a not-so-secure Samba server for file sharing, which should be 100% compatible with Windows ME. And indeed, everything works exactly as expected.
Happy Days is filmed before a live audience.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, tonight, live from Arnold's Drive.
While browsing through the files, I came across a version of the Core Pocket Media Player optimized for Windows 9X. I'm not sure why I didn't showcase this player in my previous videos, because it truly deserves more attention, mainly because it just works and can handle modern codecs. In fact, here is it playing one of my videos, the exact file that I uploaded on YouTube.
Wait.
Now let's wrap up this video with a short gaming session. Windows Millennium Edition was designed for the home user market, and when it comes to gaming, it offers solid DirectX 9 support. This means we can play great looking titles like Half-Life 2. What's more, there is even official driver support for the first generation PCI Express video cards from ATI. which interestingly were developed primarily for Windows ME rather than Windows 98, which had back then a larger market share, but these drivers are compatible with both operating systems. Now, if you are wondering whether a fast CPU might cause complications, well, based on the Windows games I have tested so far, there is nothing wrong with using a powerful hardware. On the contrary, we can max out the settings, especially with a powerful GPU like this Nvidia 7900GS. However, it's worth noting that this GPU requires some patching to work properly. The same patches are also needed for the 6000 series, even though they are officially supported in Windows ME. Now, when it comes to DOS gaming, it's well known that fast CPUs can cause issues with certain games, but on a system like this, it can sometimes be hard to pinpoint the cause of a crash. Was it the CPU, the memory, or the overall configuration? In any case, the vast majority of DOS games will still run without any problems. Even better, we can enjoy a complete gaming experience with sound, thanks to the CMI8738 WDM driver specifically released for Windows Millennium. These drivers work well with the Sound Blaster emulation layer provided by Windows ME, and the results are better than expected. Now I'll leave you with my friend Indy for a short DOS session with sound. Thanks for watching and stay tuned for more exciting content.
All right, Jones, how are you going to find that statue and all this junk? Oof! It's unlocked.
This ain't no ticket office.
I'm the fire inspector.
What do you take me for, a moron?